You know, usually when we're talking about the Sahaba, we have this image of like the Avengers. Except instead of a Hulk, we've got Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He's not big and green, he's big. He doesn't destroy buildings, mashallah, he's pretty strong. The beauty of the Sahaba is that they were real people. They were human beings. And subhanAllah, whenever you look at the way that the Sahaba were, even amongst them, laysu sawa, they're not all the same. Some of the Sahaba were greater than other Sahaba, but the lower amongst the Sahaba did not let that stop them. They observed the good deeds of the others and they tried to keep up with the higher of the Sahaba. And it starts off with really just that wanting to be like them. The people that you see that are role models, the people that you see of faith, whether they are Sahaba, whether they're Tabi'een, whether they're people that you just look up to, people that are taking all of the good deeds in the masjid, it starts off with just wanting to be like them, just having a sincere desire. And that can go so far. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once, he was sitting with the Sahaba and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there will be 70,000 people that will enter into Jannah without any form of accountability and without any form of punishment. By the way, the Prophet ﷺ, of course, he said Allah will take another 70,000 with each one of the 70,000 and then two handfuls and so on and so forth. So it became expanded. So don't feel destroyed. The point is that when you hear a hadith like that, let's say that was the end. 70,000 people get to make it to Jannah. Without any form of accountability, without any form of punishment. Imagine all of the thousands of years of Muslims, like, how am I going to be one of them? I've got to compete with over 10,000 Sahaba in Fath Mecca alone. So that brings it down to 60,000. Then the Tabi'een and the Tabi'at, you've already got way more than 70,000 in just those first three generations. And the Prophet ﷺ said they're the first three generations. Wow, I've got no hope, I've got no chance. Now there's a Sahabi who's sitting there by the name of Ukasha radiallahu anhu. Ukasha is not a famous companion. Ukasha is not from the 10 guaranteed paradise. Ukasha is not from the highest class of Sahaba. I challenge any one of you to find another hadith about Ukasha. He's the average Mo. He's just the Sahabi that's there and he's one of the other Sahaba. But that didn't stop him. He didn't sit there and think to himself like, man, I'm in trouble. Ukasha said right away, Ya Rasulullah, ad'u Allah an akuna minhum. Make dua to Allah that I am amongst them. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Anta minhum. Congratulations, you are one of them. So then some of the other Sahaba woke up. They said, whoa, it's that easy? So another Sahabi said, Ya Rasulullah, ad'u Allah an akuna minhum. Make dua that I'm amongst them. The Prophet ﷺ said, Sabaqaka biha Ukasha. Ukasha beat you to it. You just want to be there. He didn't think to himself about his limited circumstances. He didn't think that, you know what, I'm not Abu Bakr or Umar or Uthman or Ali. I'm not any of those Sahaba. I'm just Ukasha. In another incident, Haram bintu Milhan radiallahu ta'ala anha was sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam slept in her house. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam woke up from a dream and he started laughing. So she said, O Messenger of Allah, may Allah keep you happy. May Allah keep you smiling. What did you see in your dream? I saw a group of people from my ummah spreading Islam through the seas. These were desert Arabs. So the Prophet ﷺ was smiling and he was laughing because he saw that a group of his ummah would even go to that length. Umm Haram radiallahu anha, she did not say to herself, well, I'm a woman. She didn't think that way. And she didn't think to herself, well, I'm never going to be in battle. And I can't travel by seas. She said to the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, make dua that I am amongst them. I don't care how or why. Somehow, I want to be one of those people. I know that I can't be one of those people, technically speaking. It doesn't all make sense. It doesn't all add up. But I want to be one of those people. And Rasulullah ﷺ granted her that. And she was married to the great companion Ubadat ibn Samit radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And they were under Muawiyah radiallahu anhu and traveling the seas for the fatih, for the opening of Cyprus. She accompanied her husband Ubadah to Cyprus. Whenever they got to Cyprus, as she was getting out of the ship, she tripped and she fell and she died. Subhanallah. Until today, if you go to Cyprus, you can find her grave there. She didn't think to herself, it's not possible. I can't be those people. Technically, it doesn't add up, but it's not about that. If you are sincere, when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be amongst them, Allah will make it happen. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu used to make dua, Allahumma inni as'aluka shahadata fi sabilik. Oh Allah, I ask you shahada in your way. Fi baladi nabiyyik, in the city of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his daughter Hafsa radiallahu anha says, you know, how are you going to die a martyr in Medina? This is the stronghold. This is the fortress. Right? People will die as martyrs outside of Medina. SubhanAllah, he doesn't care about how it adds up. He just wanted it. And him wanting it was enough for Allah to grant him shahada, martyrdom, not only in the city of the Prophet ﷺ, in the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, and then to be buried next to the Prophet ﷺ. You want it, it will happen. But how bad do you really want it?
Download our mobile applications or register on our official website to get access to exclusive content. Links given in description of video.